Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you all for coming. So so let me first motivate this notion of extension complexity, which we define more formally later. So let's start with a simple example. So up there, we see a regular hexagon, and as you can see, it has six faces, so six edges. And we can describe this regular hexagon by linear inequality. So in other words, that would be by the intersection of half sides. And if we want to describe this regular hexagon by linear inequalities, we will need at least six inequalities to do so, because it has six faces, six edges. However, here's a curious observation. We can look at this three-dimensional polytope. So there exists this three-dimensional polytope, which has only five faces, and its projection is this regular hexagon with six faces. So we can obtain this hexagon with six faces from this solid with only five faces. And I want to point out that this construction only works for certain hexagons, so there's something special about the regular hexagon and certain other hexagons. For most hexagons, we can't do this. Okay, so here's again this observation. A regular hexagon has six faces. However, it is possible to obtain it as a projection of a three-dimensional polytope with only five faces. And this motivates this notion of extension complexity. The clicker is not working. Sorry, did you do something? The clicker doesn't work anymore.
Go ahead.
Doesn't work.
It's working.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, no, okay, yes. So it motivates this definition of extension complexity. So the extension complexity of a d-dimensional polytope P is defined to be the minimum number of faces in a possibly higher dimensional polytope P prime, such that one can obtain the original polytope P as the image of P prime under a linear projection. So in this example, we can take P to be this regular hexagon, and if we take P prime to be this three-dimensional polytope with only five faces, we see that the extension complexity of a regular hexagon is at most five. And in fact, one can show that the extension complexity of a regular hexagon equals five. So we can't do any better than this sort of example for P prime. Okay. Someone says in the chat that only half of the slides are seen, and now I can't see the rest of the message. Is the technology person still here? Jessica Vincent says it works for her, and the slides are shared.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so here's again the definition of extension complexity. The extension complexity, as we said, of a d-dimensional polytope P is the minimum number of facets of a polytope P prime from which one can get P as a projection. And if you see this definition for the first time, it may sound like a very odd notion. However, extension complexity has actually been studied for a long time, for around 30 years. And the reason why this definition is relevant is because it comes up in combinatorial optimization problems. And so the reason is roughly as follows. If you want to solve some combinatorial optimization problem over the polytope P, then how efficient we can do this depends on how many faces P has. So if P has a lot of faces, the algorithm won't be as efficient for solving our optimization problem. However, if there is such a polytope P prime with fewer faces, which projects to P, then we can lift the whole optimization problem to P prime, and we may obtain a much more efficient algorithm if P prime has fewer faces. So for that reason, this weird-looking notion of extension complexity is actually important and relevant and has been studied for a long time. In particular, there's been a lot of work on the extension complexity of specific polytopes which are relevant in optimization problems. For example, the traveling salesman polytope, which comes up in the traveling salesman problem, and the perfect matching polytope, which comes up in problems of finding perfect matchings which optimize certain functions. In general, however, it's a difficult problem to determine the extension complexity of any given polytope. Even if it's a fairly simple polytope, it's a hard problem to determine the extension complexity. So here's again the definition. And the area of combinatorics that I work in the most is called extremal combinatorics. And extremal combinatorics, roughly speaking, studies the maximum or minimum size that a combinatorial quantity can take. And here's a very natural extremal question about extension complexity. So one can ask about the maximum possible extension complexity of a polytope if we prescribe, say, the number of vertices to be n. So what is the maximum possible extension complexity of a polytope with n vertices? And it turns out that it's equivalent to ask with n vertices or with n faces. So let's stick to n vertices for now. It's not hard to show that every n vertex polytope must have extension complexity at most n. So that gives us an upper bound. And then we can also show that the extension complexity of an n minus one dimensional n vertex simplex is actually equal to n. So that means this upper bound is obtained by this simplex. And so the answer to this question is n. We already solved the question. Okay, that wasn't that interesting. But note that in our example where this upper bound n was attained, we took an n minus one dimensional polytope. So what happens if we restrict the dimension? Here, this n minus one, we can cross with n. What if we restrict ourselves to a fixed dimension? So then we arrive at the following open, very interesting open problem. For fixed dimension d and large n, what is the maximum possible extension complexity of a d-dimensional polytope with n vertices? And it was actually widely believed that for any dimension d, the extension complexity of an n-vertex polytope can be as large as n. So we saw that n is always an upper bound, but it was widely believed that even if you restrict the dimension d to whatever we want, we still get it. This was disproved in 2014, independently by Shitov and by Patron and Pfeiffer. And the best, so then the upper bound got approved a few times. The best current upper bound of d equals 2 is the following, a result of Shitov from earlier this year. He proved that in dimension 2, and for an n-vertex poly, two-dimensional n-vertex polytope, that would just be n-gon. An n-gon always has extension complexity at most of the order of n to the 2/3. So that means you can't go all the way up to n. So for d bigger than 2, there are no non-trivial upper bounds known though. So for d equals 3, it is a priori still possible that the extension complexity could go all the way up to n. And that's not known. Okay, so here's again the question. So we just on the last slide discussed upper bounds, but what about lower bounds, right? If we want to ask about the maximum possible, we can also ask about today, what are the best possible constructions we can know? We know, so what's the best, the highest extension complexity we can show is actually possible. And Pat Hall in 2016 proved that almost all d-dimensional polytopes with n vertices have extension complexity at least on the order of square root n. So not only did he show it is possible to get extension complexity square root n, he actually showed almost all polytopes have that property. And that's actually a common idea in also what's called probabilistic combinatorics, where if you want to kind of construct some sort of lower bound, instead of focusing on a particular object, you show that a random object, so here she showed almost all, but that's closely related to a random object, has your desired properties. So in other words, that then leads to the following, I think, fairly natural question. So if you think that it's a natural approach to finding lower bound to this question up here, to consider random polytopes, it's then a natural question to ask, well, what actually is the extension complexity of a random d-dimensional polytope with n vertices? So instead of considering all possibilities for the polytopes, you just take a random one. And Padua proved this lower bound of order square root n for the extension complexity of a random polytope, even though that wasn't exactly the setting it was in, but that's basically what his result implies. But that doesn't tell us anything. What is the actual value? Is it actually square root n or is it more? And so this question is relevant for two reasons. The first reason is it provides lower bounds for this question up here, But the second reason is also random polytopes are a common topic of study in probability theory, and there's rich literature around them. And then extension complexity is another important quantity that's studied. So it's a natural question to ask, to combine the two and ask, well, what's the extension complexity of a random polytope? So here's again the question, what's typically the extension complexity of a randomly dimensional polytope with n vertices where d is fixed and n is large? And so the next thing, if you talk about random polytopes, you should say, well, what sort of random model do you use? What do you mean by random polytope? And so in this work, which is joint work with Matthew Kwan and Luke Zhao, we considered two different models of random polytopes for which we answered this question. And so the two models we were considering were as follows. So one of them was that we picked n independent uniformly random points on the unit sphere in Rd, and then we took the polytope P to be their convex hull. So then P will be a polytope with exactly n vertices, with probability 1, the points will be distinct. And the second model was that we picked m independent uniformly random points, this time in the unit ball in Rd, and again let the polytope P be the convex hull. So in this case, not all of our m points will be vertices of the polytope, because some may lie in the convex hull of the others, but we work in probability figuring out what typically the number of vertices of such a polytope is, and then you can choose your m appropriately, but the number of vertices will be of order n. Okay, and so we showed that for both of these models of random polytopes, the extension complexity is asymptotically almost truly, so that means with probability 1 as m and n tend to infinity, on the order of the square root of the number of vertices. And so I want to point out here that the interesting part is the upper bound, because the lower bound essentially already follows from the result of Padwell on the previous slide and other results in that direction. But the new part here is to prove upper bounds on the extension complexity of these random polytopes. And so up to a constant factor, we determine the order of the extension complexity, and it's equal to the square root of the number of vertices. Okay, so here's again our results stated a little bit more condensedly. So we consider a random polytope chosen either as the convex hull of n random points in the unit sphere or as the convex hull of n random points in the unit ball. And then in either case, the extension complexity is asymptotically almost truly on the order of the square root of the number of vertices. So we started earlier with this open question about the maximum possible extension complexity of any d-dimensional polytope with n vertices. And so now this result is attempting to conjecture that for this open question, the extension complexity is actually always on the order of square root n. And so here's some heuristic why you might expect, I mean, this is only a heuristic, but here's some heuristic why you might expect that these random polytopes really attain the maximum extension complexity. So if you think back of the example with the regular hexagon we started with in the beginning, we saw that it was a special property of the regular hexagon and of some other hexagons that you could do this construction which gives you extension complexity only 5. And that most hexagons have extension complexity 6. So it seems to be somehow a special thing that you have lower extension complexity. And so in that sense, it's plausible to conjecture that random polytopes really do exhibit the maximum possible extension complexity, but that's only an intuition and it's not at all clear. So I think it's a very interesting question to figure out whether the extension complexity is always on the order of square root n, as this result suggests or not. And if you want to make your, so this is a very hard question most likely, but if you want to make your life a bit more easy, you can ask about special families of polytopes. So if you restrict P to be a d-dimensional n-vertex polytope with all vertices on a common sphere, can you then prove an upper bound on the order of or square root n for the extension complexity? And that's also still open, but we proved that the answer is yes for the equals 2. So again, joined with Matthew Kwan and Yu-Fei Zhao, we proved that from n gon, so a two-dimensional polytope with n vertices, where all vertices lie on a common circuit, the extension complexity is always at most 24 square root n, and this is tied up to the constant factor of 24. And here's a picture illustrating such a polygon. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Hello, can you, do you hear me?
Yes, I do hear you.
Yeah, I just want to make a remark and suggest kind of an opposite philosophy, because there is some experience coming up from the area of I-dimension expanders, which suggests that random are not as good or are not as complex as the so-called Ramanujan complexes. That in fact, in a higher dimensional, there is kind of a switch and some very particular examples, which are based on some number theory, are more complex. This, for example, seems to happen in the so-called Gromov topological expanders. I don't know if Shai Evra is in the audience. He was at the Institute for 2 years and is now at the university. But his work is related to that. And maybe there are particular examples that will need more complexity somehow.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think the answer could go either way, but I think it's a very interesting, I mean, in general, it's interesting to answer that open question what the answer is, but I'm also specifically interested in whether O of square root n is true or not, because, I mean, the random intuition suggests O of square root n, but as you just pointed out, there may also be factors going the opposite way, and I think that's a very interesting remark that you just made.
I have a question. Hello?
Yes?
So if you just say look at polygons with some number of vertices and you fix a projection complexity and then you say what's the set of all of them that have exactly that complexity or less or equal to that, do you know what that set is like?
Okay, so hopefully you remember. I thought about this, but hopefully you remember correctly. I think, so if you take the ones which have extension complexity at most, I think it should be a closed set. Right, because the polygons you can take up there, which have at most that number of faces.
But I mean, is it like a variety or something, or semi-algebraic?
You have some sort of closed set of kind of polytopes P prime. You could take kind of these higher dimensional ones, which have at most that many faces, and then if you project them down, I mean, it should still be closed. So I think the things with low extension complexity should form a closed set, which kind of goes aligned with intuition that kind of something generic should kind of have higher extension complexity. Mm. But I mean, this is not a proof. This is just, again, an intuition.
Gotcha.
How universal are your results in terms of the probabilistic model?
Sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
You had one probabilistic model, you had a lower bound, which you didn't describe what the probabilistic choice is. Is the answer of square root n, say, true for pretty much, what's the condition on the probability distribution?
So there were just two particular probabilistic models we considered. Right.
So I'm asking, do you think that's much more universal? Meaning, somehow if you make the choice sufficient entropy or something, that it would be the same answer?
Yeah, so that would be very interesting. I think our proof would work more generally, because part of what we use in the proof is that the vertices in both of these models tend to be fairly well distributed over the sphere or close to the sphere. So in particular, we use things like the vertices are not too much clumped together in one place in the sphere, and they are also, the faces are not too big, so there are not too many empty parts of the sphere. And so I think as long as you, I mean, I think from what we do, you can extract a deterministic result, which would be of the form, if you assume you have a polytope where the vertices are well distributed in basically the two senses I was just describing, then you get that bound for the extension complexity. But now, kind of, it depends on your model whether you would get this well distributedness of the vertices for a random object.
Yeah, no, but that's a very good answer. I mean, if you have a deterministic version, that's very clear. Yeah, you clarify what you're using. Yeah.
Yeah, so we didn't write in the paper with the explicit deterministic thing, but there is a kind of section which first talks about what properties the random polytopes have that we are data using. So from that, one can very easily extract the deterministic version.
Okay.
I think you also had a question.
Where does the 24 come from?
So we weren't really super careful with the bounds, so I think one could probably go through the proof and replace the 24 by a better constant, so there's no real reason. But I don't think our methods would be likely to give a tight constant, so we didn't really bother optimizing the arguments. Because that would have added more technical details, and the proof was already technical enough in some places.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.